The Body Church is dedicated to proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ through authentic worship, Bible study, and service. Located in Atlanta, we're called to create a loving and caring community for all people and work together for justice and truth in our world. Recognizing that our spiritual journeys are all different, we strive to help people discover where they fit and pursue their purpose in Christ. If you've been searching for a place where real people with real problems are searching for genuine solutions, The Body Church may very well be the perfect fit. Visit thebodychurchinc.org for service times or call us if you have any questions.
Thank you for your word. We pray, God, for wisdom, that you would speak to us today, that we would hear your voice, that it would be exactly what we need to hear. We pray right now, God, for each person in this room. We pray, God, that each person will receive what you have for each of us. And we declare, God, that this is your house. This is the day that you have made. We rejoice and we're glad in it. And we pray, Lord, each person has intelligence, the spirit of intelligence, the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of you, that we will hear from God, we will hear from heaven. And we pray that each person will walk away from this place today knowing something more from your word. We declare there will be no distractions, that there will be no attempt of the enemy to get in our way, that we will successfully connect with your throne and with your heart. And hear your voice. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody say, amen. All right, good. So we are going to have ourselves a quick message. Somebody say, quick message.
Quick message.
We're going to be in, we're going to be out, but it's still going to be good. You know what I'm saying? We're going to continue on this series because that's what we do. We do series. And we're going to keep working on this and keep squeezing this until we get everything out of it that we possibly can. So let's begin with our assignment on the screen, the series 1, Ephesians 4, 11 to 13. Let's read together after 3, 2, 3. And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. The assignment of the fivefold ministry gifts, the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher, continues until the entire church is unified in the faith. That's why we're teaching this, because we understand that the scripture says, till we all come to the unity of the faith. Everybody understands that? So, one body, many parts. That's what we're all about. As you know, you can do anything to come up with a church, and you can make up anything, and you can come up with any name or whatever. And the Lord told us, this is for us. One body, many parts. 1 Corinthians 12:12. Let's read it together. After 3, 2, 3. The human body has many parts, but the many parts make up one whole body. So it is with the body of Christ. So here we use the body of Christ as a body and the illustration of a body to help us understand what the church is supposed to be like. Everybody gets that?
Yes.
So the church can be compared to a human body. In fact, let's read it together since we've been doing this every week. After 3, 2, 3. The church can be compared to a human body. Each part is unique, looks different, and functions in a different capacity. Just like the human body, we have only one head, Jesus. We are only at our best when the entire body works together as a coordinated unit. Everybody gets that? We're going to pound this into our heads forever until we walk away and we all get it. Everybody understands? We probably already got it, but hey, we're just going to get it more. Until, yeah, we got it. And remember the prayer of Jesus for unity. John 17, 9 to 23. Let's go to there. And this is why we're going to keep reading this. Anything that you repeat, eventually you begin to internalize it. Mm-hmm. It's like any activity you repeat becomes a habit. If you come to church enough, it becomes a habit. And then you can't not come to church. You're just going to feel weird in the same way. We're going to go through the scripture over and over and over until after a while, it's just going to be normal for us. If somebody ever mentions any piece of the scripture, we're just going to be like, yeah, you know that. Why? Because we pounded it like 100 times, literally. You know what I'm saying? John 17, 9 to 23, I pray for them. I do not pray for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. And all mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. Now, I am no longer in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to you, Holy Father. Keep through your name those whom you have given me, that they may be one, as we are. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in your name. Those whom you gave me, I have kept, and none of them is lost except the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I come to you, and these things I speak in the world, that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I've given them your word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I do not pray that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also may be sanctified by the truth. I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they all may be one, as you, Father, are in me, and I in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. And the glory which you have given me, I have given them, that they may be one, just as we are one, I in them and you in me, that they may be perfect or made perfect in one, and that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. Father, I desire that they also whom you gave me may be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory which you have given me. For you loved me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, the world has not known you, but I have known you, and these have known that you sent me. And I have declared to them your name, and will declare it, that the love with which you love me may be in them, and I in them. So when Jesus knew that the time of his death was imminent, he prayed one of the most important prayers he had ever prayed. He prayed for unity in his body. And contained in that prayer are secrets for divine unity. And we are going through that prayer piece by piece until, well, I can't say until there's nothing left. There's always going to be something left. Until we can't find anything else. And then we'll move on onto something else. Everybody understands that? So if you don't like talking about unity, it's going to be hard for you. Because we're going to talk about this thing until we don't know what else to see. Then we're moving on. So Jesus' seven secrets of unity, which we grabbed from that scripture. Let's go ahead and go through this list from number one after three, two, three. Number one, the name of Christ unites. Number two, God's word sets us apart. Number three, our mission unites us. Number four, we are only one in him. Number five, God's glory unites us. Number six, unity testifies of Jesus. Number seven, the love of Christ unites us. God's glory makes us one. John 17, 22 to 23. Let's read it together on the screen after three, two, three. And the glory which you gave me, I have given them, that they may be one, just as we are one. I in them, and you in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that you have sent me, and have loved them as you have loved me. So the key to this is the underlying portion. So let's read the underlying portion alone. After three, two, three. And the glory which you have given me, making stuff up. Let's go again. Two, three. And the glory which you gave me, I have given them, that they may be one, just as we are one. So that's the point. We're like, listen, you gave me your glory, Jesus, so we could be one. And that's the goal of the whole thing. We are saying to ourselves, all right, if the glory of God can make us one, let's understand what's being said so that we can all have a desire for it. Everybody understands that? So God's glory makes us one. As a result, it's important for God's glory to be evident among us if we are to experience true unity. What is God's glory? The Hebrew word. Let's read it together. Kabod. And what does it mean? God's substance, essence, heavy presence. When God shows up in his glory, everyone present feels the weight of it. Good deal? Now let's go to the Greek word. Doxa. That's what I'm talking about. Hello. That's what I'm talking about. He's like, yes, I know what glory is. Doxa. All right. So what does the word doxa mean? Let's read it together after three, two, three. The unspoken manifestation of God, the divine quality of God, and God's infinite intrinsic worth. Good deal. See, when the young ones even know that, there's grown folks who don't know what doxa means. An encounter with God's glory. Acts 2, 1 to 4. Let's read it together on the screen. Two, three. On the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly, there was a sound from heaven like the roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then, what looked like flames of tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. Everybody knows this story. This is how the church started. The Holy Spirit showed up. It was a set of action. And next thing you know, boom, this happens. The day of Pentecost. Everybody's excited. But what we realize is at the end of what happened there in the upper room, the church started. And there's a direct relationship between when the Holy Spirit showed up and the glory of God manifested and how the church looked when it first started. We can't separate one from the other. So we can't try to reproduce the end of Acts 2 without realizing we need the beginning of Acts 2 also. No Holy Spirit moving? No, and they all came together and they all broke bread and all the stuff. We can't have that. We got to have both. Everybody understands that? So we can't artificially reproduce something without going through all the steps. I can't see somebody's cake and be like, wow, I want that cake, and then try to make the cake. And I forget there's a whole process to the cake, ingredients and directions and stuff like that. So what we don't want to do as a church is look at the picture and then try to figure it out from the picture when there are instructions and there are directions, how they did it. So this process started with the Holy Ghost. Everybody understands that? Good. But how did it end up? Acts 2, 36 to 47. I'm going to read that. Because as I said, many people in all of our lives, there's things that we just fantasize about. Where we're like, oh, that's my dream car. That's my dream house. Or my dream spouse. Or my dream shoes. Well, for the church, this is our dream church. The book of Acts. That's our dream. Anybody who's been in church long enough, you will always hear, man, when they were in the book of Acts, that's how church is supposed to be. Right. That's our dream. What can we do to see our dream come true? Everybody understands that? When your church looks like this, you know your dream has come true. Acts 2, 36 to 47. Here's the Apostle Peter. Holy Spirit just came. Everybody's looking at them. They're talking in tongues. And folks are like, bah, they are drunk. And he's like, no, we're not drunk. This is what Joel prophesied. It's the Holy Ghost. It's amazing. It's the last days. And he gives a long message. And he brings the message to a close at around verse 36. So let's roll from there. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, that's pretty bold, both Lord and Christ. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said to them, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call. And with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Then those who gladly received this word were baptized. And that day, about 3,000 souls were added to them. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in prayers. Then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Now, all who believed were together and had all things in common and sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. We know the story. So on the day of Pentecost, about 120 believers experienced the most well-known release of God's glory in human history. That initial widespread encounter changed human history forever. And from it, we can learn valuable lessons about what happens when people see God's glory. And that's what we just read. People saw God's glory. That stuff happened. What's that stuff? We break it down into points. What happens when we seek God's glory? This is what we just read. Let's go through this list. From number one, God gives us bold words to speak. Let's read number two. We are driven to repentance. Number three, we get a strong sense of devotion. Number four, we see miracles. Number five, we are drawn together as a community. Number six, we raise our level of worship and praise. And number seven, we are set free and transformed. So here's an amazing thing. Holy Spirit shows up. Everybody's excited. They're talking in tongues. But the story doesn't end there. Next thing you know, people get bold. Because it started off with tongues, where they were just speaking glory of God. They were giving God glory. They were talking about his wonderful works, and they didn't know what they were saying. And we looked at how several times in the scripture, every time they needed boldness, they knew who to go to, the Holy Ghost. Let the Lord show up, and next thing you know, everybody's bold. You get that? We are driven to repentance. People came to Peter and the apostles and said, so what shall we do, men and brethren? And what did Peter say? Repent. Because when you see the Holy Spirit moving, you want to repent. And it's cool. Ain't nothing wrong with a little judgment. At the end of the day, it makes everybody get better. It makes everybody want to get right. And that's cool. Like, nothing to run from. The Holy Ghost comes and convicts you. Well, sweet. You got convicted. Why? So he can make you right. You get right, you're good. That's what it's all about. The thing is, what you would need to be scared of is when you don't feel convicted. Yeah. When you can do anything and you don't feel convicted. Yes. That's when you're like, oops, I'm in trouble. Because yeah. I can do whatever and I don't feel no conviction. That's, you ever met somebody, and you know when you talk, when they talk about when somebody got to that point where they have no remorse, those are the people you have to lock up because nothing will stop them. There's nothing to stop you. And my thing is, you don't want to get there. You want to be convicted. It's fine. You don't get mad and say, oh, I'm convicted. It's God, you're convicted. Then that means the Holy Ghost is still knocking on your door and you can hear him knock. Your job is to open the door. That's what conviction is. He's knocking, saying, so, you want to repent or not? Like, oh, I guess I should repent. Yes. And you're straight. Let's keep rolling. You see what I'm saying? We get a strong sense of devotion. We realize these people were committed to Jesus. They were committed to the church. They were committed. They were devoted to the apostles' teaching, to breaking bread, to fellowship, to prayer. The Holy Spirit showed up. You see fire on somebody's head and you hear them speaking in your language and you know they don't speak your language. You start thinking, I better roll with these guys because these guys are special. You want to roll with people who have the Holy Ghost with them. They're special. They're not like everybody else. Everybody understands that? And we want that kind of stuff to happen around us so that we can be like, hey, I ain't going nowhere. I'm not going to be half in, half out, sitting down watching reruns and missing church because the Holy Spirit's there. You see what I'm saying? You get devoted when that stuff happens. We see miracles and we know in the glory of God, this is probably the easiest one. Everybody knows if the glory of God is manifested, there's going to be miracles. Yeah. That ain't rocket science. That's why we be like, Lord, we want your presence because we need some stuff to get done. We don't feel like struggling with our human limitations. We need some miracles. Hence, we need the Holy Ghost to show up. Everybody understands that? And today, we are drawn together as a community. Ladies and gentlemen, easy stuff. God's glory pulls us together. God's glory pulls us together. Acts 2, 44 to 46. Acts 2, 44 to 46. On the screen, let us read it together. 2, 3. And all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and generosity. They saw something amazing. They saw God resting on people. They saw people transformed by God resting on them. And they were like, we need to stick together. Because everybody else is not like us. We are Christ followers. We are following what they called back then the way. And they had encountered the Holy Ghost to a point where their lives were just rocked and they were different. And they were like, hey, we got the Holy Ghost. We got the glory of God. We're going to roll with each other. And one of the things we want to see is the glory of God together. Because if we all encounter God's glory together, we all start thinking, we can roll with each other. We can hang out because we see the glory of God together. Everybody understands that? So here's the point. Before the Holy Ghost showed up in the upper room, the disciples were in one accord in one place. However, after the Holy Ghost showed up, they were one. Big difference. They were one and they were one accord in one place, but after the Holy Ghost, you can separate them. Because all of a sudden, the Holy Ghost was like the glue that stuck them together. At that point, the church, the body of Christ was born. And that's what we're looking at. The Holy Ghost comes, and all our efforts to be together gets transformed to a whole different level because now the Holy Ghost is the glue that pulls us together. Everybody understands that? Excellent. Jesus challenged his followers. We want to talk about this. The Lord just put that on me to talk about. John 6, 35 to 39. There was a time when Jesus challenged those who were following him. John 6, 35 to 39. When you're there, say amen. John 6, 35 to 39. Everybody there? And Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me, and yet do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me I will by no means cast out. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. This is the will of the Father who sent me, that of all he has given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up at the last day. And this is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life. And I will raise him at the last day. So Jesus raised the intensity of his ministry and challenged the commitment of his followers. He said, listen, you know what? These people are with me. Ain't nobody can take them from me. They're with me. And he said, you know what? I'm set. Nobody's going anywhere. Nobody's going to take them from me. And I'm not casting them out. You see what I'm saying? Did we hear what Jesus said? But what happened? Many of the disciples actually left Jesus. So let's go from verse 41 to 59. I totally missed that. The Jews then complained about him because he said, I am the bread which came down from heaven. And they said, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How is it then that he says, I am come down from heaven? Jesus therefore answered and said to them, do not murmur among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they shall all be taught by God. And they shall all be taught by God. Therefore, everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except he who is from God. He has seen the Father. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me has everlasting life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread and came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I shall give you is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world. The Jews therefore quarreled among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Then Jesus said to them, most assuredly I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so he who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers ate the manna and are dead. He who eats this bread will live forever. These things he said in the synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. So he raised the intensity of his ministry. And he challenged the commitment of his followers. He's like, listen, you know what? It's cool. I can do miracles. We can have fun. But you know what? If you really want to be a part of me, you have to eat my flesh and drink my blood. And folks were like, okay. What just happened? He just upped the scale instantly. He's like, you gotta get me. It's gotta be about me. And that was the bottom line. It's like, it's not eat the fish that I multiplied, not eat the bread I multiplied, not enjoy the miracles. If you want to be a part of me, you gotta have me. I am the grand prize. Eat me. I am that prize. You gotta drink my blood, you gotta eat my flesh. And obviously, there are layers to what he's saying. One layer is, I'm about to die on the cross, and everybody has to accept me as their Lord and Savior as I die on the cross. That's the only way you're going to get an opportunity to be a part of the body of Christ. You have to accept the sacrifice on the cross. So that was one layer of interpretation. It's got to be this blood that I'm about to shed. It's got to be this flesh that I'm about to break and offer for you. Number one, you have to have that. So that's understood. And that answers the question of people who say, well, do Jews have to accept Jesus too? Yes, of course. Everybody got to accept Jesus. Ain't nobody getting to heaven without Jesus. You got to get Jesus. And Jesus is saying, and you all think you're cool, but hey, you got to have me. You got to eat my flesh. You got to drink my blood. And folks were like, I'm offended. Mm-hmm. And let's move on to the offense. John 6, 68 to 66. Many disciples left Jesus. Verse 60. Therefore, many of his disciples, when they heard this, said, this is a hard saying. Who can understand it? And now New Living Translation actually says, how can anyone accept it? Deep. When Jesus knew in himself that his disciples complained about this, he said to them, does this offend you? What then if you should see the Son of Man ascend where he was before? And then he says something profound. Verse 63. And I want you to remember that verse. It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life. So he's like, my words are spirit and my words are life. But there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were who did not believe and who would betray him. And he said, therefore, I have said to you that no one can come to me unless it has been granted to him by my Father. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Mm-hmm. So many people were offended when Jesus challenged their level of commitment and walked away. They didn't understand that the words of Jesus were the spiritual, life-giving words of God. And when they left Jesus, they left the Spirit of God behind. When they turned away from Jesus, they were turning their back on God. And they didn't understand that. And they didn't understand that when Jesus spoke, the same words that they were so offended of, those were the words of life. Those were the spirit words. If you want God, if you want his Holy Spirit, you got to have Jesus. And if you want Jesus, you got to take what he's singing. And he's saying, y'all need me. And he's like, nothing else matters. You got to get these words. You got to get the spirit. You got to get the life-giving power. And it's only going to come if you stay here with me and you accept me for who I am. And not the miracles, not the things I can do for you. You got to accept me for me. And I'm going to tell you some things. And these words I'm telling you are going to give you life. They are going to give you spirit. You want the Holy Ghost? I'm going to tell you. And what you hear, the Spirit of God is on these words. Everybody hears that? So here is Jesus saying, you all want God? You want the presence of God? My words have the Spirit of God on them. You don't want to feel God, you don't want to hear God, my words have life-giving power. Mm-hmm. If you just hang around me, I'm just going to say things, and when I say them, God's being released upon you. The Spirit's being released upon you. You hear my words, my Spirit's actually coming at you. Mm-hmm. In other words, he's saying, my Spirit is actually, it's almost like the words of God are like the vehicle through which he can release his Spirit upon you. He's like, you want my spirit? I'm going to speak some words and my spirit would be encapsulated in these words. And now I can transfer my spirit to you through these words. Everybody understands that? But people were offended. Because they didn't, number one, they didn't understand what he was saying. And two, they were like, drink your blood, ain't your flesh. Oh, he's gone. He's too much. Everybody left except the 12 disciples, which is why when people talk about the disciples, we only think about the 12, but he had a lot more disciples up until that point. He had the 12, that was the inner circle, and then he also had a bunch more. And it came to that point where he was like, he challenged them. He's like, the only people who are going to get to hang with me are the people who are going to be with me for me. You're going to eat my flesh, you're going to drink my blood. That's all. He's like, who wants this? And the rest of them were like, I don't want that. And he's like, cool. Then he looks at his disciples, and here's what he says, verse 67 to 69. Then Jesus said to the 12, do you also want to go away? But Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Also, we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered them. An answer. So here is the Apostle Peter, before he was Apostle Peter, responding to Jesus. When Jesus saw everybody leaving, he was like, so you guys leaving too? And he's like, we're not going anywhere. Listen to the reasons he gives for why they're not leaving. He gave two reasons. One, you have the words of life. So they recognized that encapsulated in the words of Jesus is the Spirit of God, the living, breathing Spirit of God. You see what I'm saying? Number one. And number two, he says, we believe and we realize you are Jesus, the Son of the living God. So they actually recognized, hey, you're God. Two, when you speak, the Spirit of God is on your words. Why are we going anywhere? You realize that? So Peter gave a reason for why the 12 weren't leaving. Two things. We recognize that your words have the Spirit, the living Spirit of God in them. And we know who you are. You're Jesus, Son of the living God. So the 12 disciples remained together because they realized that Jesus had the words of life, and they recognized that Jesus was the manifestation of God. In the same way, when we hear God's voice and see his manifestation among us, we will never leave. Amen. They looked at Jesus and they were like, you are God. God has manifested himself, and here he is standing before us. And when you speak, we hear God. And your words have spirit, your words have life. You are the one with the words of life. And you are God manifested in the earth. Where are we going? Everybody else was out. But the 12 knew that's enough to keep us here. In the same way, when we as a group can hear God's voice together, and as a group can see God manifested among us together, who's going anywhere? Everybody else could be offended. They'd be like, I don't care what he say. I can't believe that. That's too hard. And walk away. But those who recognize, no, but I see God. God is here. And two, I hear God's words. When I hear those words, those aren't just words. That's the spirit. That's the life of God. And the words are just the vehicle to release the spirit and the life of God. Everybody understands that? Because we're not going to have Jesus physically stand up here, ever. If that ever happens, we're all going to fall and faint. It's rare. It's just not, it's unlikely. What we're going to have is the Spirit of God, the Holy Ghost will manifest. The Holy Ghost, the glory of God will manifest. That's what we can access now. And for us, the same way Jesus being there was God in the flesh, that was the manifestation of God for them. For us, the Holy Ghost showing up and manifesting himself is for us. For us to be like, well, we know that you're the Holy Ghost. We're not going anywhere. And we know when the Holy Ghost speaks in this place, those are the words of life. We're not going anywhere. I don't know about the rest of them, but that's enough to keep me. Everybody understands? And as a result, as a church, we want to get to